Good evening, fellow misplaced heads. Mrs. Radhika Surajit's, a proponent of classical dance, had detailed about the depth of the art form, its transformation through the centuries, the way it was kept alive by the Devadasi system of temple dancer. She had appreciated the author, Ms. Jayanti Shankar's, extensive research and comprehensive yet interesting intertwining of the science and beauty of the art in Misplaced Heads. Ms. Vidya Velayudham has had announced her empathy towards the protagonist Purna and how her plight had affected her emotionally. It was good to know Misplaced Heads had engrossed the reader, not just literally but psychologically struck a connection with them deep enough to emote for the characters. Both the talks were informative yet engaging and had opened scopes for further discussion last Saturday. We wish today's talks go over and beyond the standards set by the previous speakers and the audience freely take part in the fruitful discussion that might follow. Our first speaker, Dr. Revathi Subramaniam, works as an assistant professor in English in Chellammal Women's College, Chennai. She is a doctorate degree holder in English literature. She is interested in African literature and Indian writing in English. She has several paper presentations and publications to her credit. We await such an esteemed scholar's take on gender roles in Misplaced Heads. Ma'am, over to you.
Okay, thank you for that wonderful introduction. Yeah, this is Revathi Sivasubramaniam. I reside in Chennai. You know, when I first read Jayanti Shankar's Misplaced Heads, actually I was fascinated by it. I was intrigued by it, you know. You know, one question kept haunting me as, you know, why did Raghu behave the way he did towards Purna? In fact, I asked, you know, Jayanti as, you know, why Raghu had to behave so rudely towards Purna? And then she said, you know, that's how it works. You know, the conflict drives the novel. But then I thought, you know, why? I that kept, you know, haunting me. And then I realized maybe I'll not say it is a definite answer. This is my interpretation. Maybe gender has a role to play in it. Now, hence today I'll be talking about the role of gender in Jayanti Shankar's Misplaced Heads. You know, before getting into the topic as such, you know, it is necessary to role of gender against the backdrop of a theoretical insight. You know, theoretical insights are very, very important. You know, they help you, you know, they enrich your understanding, you know. So, you know, when I was thinking about gender and the role of gender, I was actually reminded of, you know, very important essay written by, you know, bell hooks, a prominent American feminist. And she wrote a wonderful essay, Understanding Patriarchy. You know, I really loved, I enjoyed reading that essay because that essay gave a fresh perspective. You know, usually we do a lot of men bashing, you know, feminist, and then this world is divided, you know. You know, I constantly think, you know, why should we divide? You know, why, you know, a lot of binaries exist, white, black, you know, good, bad, you know, there is nothing in between, you know. That's what, you know, when I, you know, when I was doing African literature also, that's what, you know, it hit me hard that we usually think in binaries. You know, everything exists in dualism. We need to transcend this binary. That's what exactly she talks about in that essay, Understanding Patriarchy. She, you know, she deconstructs, you know, this binary of, you know, the male being the, you know, the perpetrator of violence and the female being the hapless victim. And she says that it is necessary to, she forcefully argues, actually, she argues that, you know, patriarchy, you know, has an adverse effect on both men and women. You know, it's not that, you know, patriarchy affects only women and then, you know, women are the helpless victims, you know, with no agency whatsoever, and men are those, you know, super, you know, superpowers, you know, who have everything, you know, at their disposal. Absolutely not, you know, especially after getting married, I came to know that, you know, I too believed in that myth, you know, that, you know, glorified male, that, you know, male gets whatever he wants and the female does not get what she wants. And, you know, a female is like, you know, a carpet and the male, you know, simply, you know, uses her and, you know, throws her. No, that's actually not true. You know, especially after getting married, you know, from my husband, I came to know a lot of things, you know, that men are absolutely wonderful human beings, you know, who can cook, who can clean, who can do everything just like a woman does. Then why this problem arises, you know, that's got me thinking, you know. So, you know, that I connected article of bell hooks. In that article, she beautifully says that roles, gender is, it's a social construction, it's a social conditioning, and then you need to look at gender as an, in order to have a better understanding of gender, you need to view it as an it's an experience. Patriarchy is a lived social experience, so it is rooted in experience. Experientiality is everything. So then again, I went back to my childhood, and then I was reminded we have a whole lot of cousins, and then we have male cousins and female cousins, and then our aunts would give, they would buy a whole lot of gifts, every summer. It was fun time for us. We would all congregate at our grandmother's house, and then our aunts would bring gifts. And then for girls, they would give Barbie dolls and these kitchen sets. And for boys, they would give cars and rifles and guns, And then if I never, to be very honest, I was never interested in playing with those cars or guns, nor was I interested in cooking and kitchen sets. I was glued to television, and maybe a bit of reading here and there. It was cartoons, and I was glued to television. Neither was I interested in cooking, nor was I interested in playing with those guns and toys. But I remember my cousin Lakshmi, she was interested in playing with that gun, and then immediately my grandmother sprung into action, and she said, no, Lakshmi, don't touch that. That is Swaminathan's, and you should be playing with the kitchen set. At that point of time, we did not really realize, but Lakshmi is not somebody who can, who will listen. She said, no way. You buy another car for him, I'm going to play with that car. And then, her mom swooped into action. She said, Lakshmi, that is not the way you behave. You're a good girl. Come on. I'll buy. So, after a lot of persuasion and cajoling, and then she finally moved away. But again, she did not play with that kitchen set. Poor kitchen set remained. So no female cousin was interested in playing with that kitchen set. Okay. But the boys were happily playing with those toys, but now when I realize about, when I think about that experience, I realize that, society is the biggest ideological state apparatus, Michel Althusser actually talks about, repressive state apparatus and ideological state apparatus. Please pardon me for using a bit of theory, because, I love, because they throw light, they shed light on certain issues, So repressive state apparatus, I think we need not bother about it here, but here actually that ideological state apparatus is very, very relevant, because family is the most important ideological state apparatus, because, family is the one that decimates this ideology of patriarchy, and it interpellates, it indoctrinates us, and we start, it's like, it's natural. Yes, women has to get up and cook. Yes, a man has to go out and work. That is how it is, actually, In fact, let me tell you the truth. When I first read the paragraph where, Raghu says that I'll have to cook okra, I was like, what? It didn't sound really good, because it is not normal. It is abnormal. But then again, I started, reviewing the process of who creates what is normal and who creates what is abnormal. This normal, normal and abnormal are actually societal constructions. And, they're drilled into our head by our society. And family is the most important microcosm. And then through education, I very well remember, recently my son had a Tamil, rhyme, dosa amma dosa, amma sutta dosa, appa, அம்மாவுக்கு பாப்பாவுக்கு அப்பாவுக்கு நாலு அம்மாவுக்கு மூணு பாப்பா தம்பிக்கு மூணு சோ அல்டிமேட்லி ஹூ இஸ் த ரெண்டு அண்ட் ஒன்னு ஃபைனலி ஃபார் தி கேர்ள் சைல்ட் ஒன்னு. Of course, in an urban space, it makes no sense, because, I feel somewhere we have flattened this curve, this disparity has been flattened. I'm not absolutely sure, but as far as India is concerned, definitely in rural areas, still it is ponnuku onnu or maybe nothing. And it is still the woman cooking. So again, amma sutta dosai. So again, why not, there is sexism in education also. There is nothing wrong with cooking as such. But the problem arises only when you gender the cooking. So cooking becomes a gendered practice, that a woman has to cook. I to be very honest with you, I hate cooking. I never loved cooking. And then, I didn't tell I did tell him that, you know, ours is an arranged marriage, and I did tell him that, see, I don't know cooking. Is that fine with you? He said, absolutely, you don't worry. After you get married, you'll learn to cook. Fine. I was like, okay, fine. Then I got married, and then, you know, I stay in a joint family, and then my mother-in-law is the one who, you know, who initiated me into this cooking, you know. And then slowly, you know, I have learned the ropes of the trade, and now I cook. You know, initially I was like, you know, oh my god, why I have to cook? But then slowly, you know, my husband cooks with great interest, and then slowly I was like, oh my god, he's cooking too, so good, you know. So when, you know, so when the disparity is not there, that why should I cook? Why should you, you know, you should only cook. That is not there. You know, that is very important. Don't make it a gendered practice, you know. When you gender something, that's when the problem arises. So, you know, against all these, you know, I went through this spectrum, because ultimately patriarchy is a lived social experience, and they're rooted in experiences. Experientiality is everything. So I went through this whole lot of spectrum of experiences of how my own outlook towards men has changed. You know, throughout my life, I studied in a women's college, no interaction whatsoever with men. And then my cousins also were, you know, they were very young. You know, there is a whole lot of age disparity between us, so not much of an interaction with men. But then getting married, and then, you know, and usually we are fed a lot of stories about men, that men are, you know, they're horrible, they'll make use of you, they'll make you cook, and they'll not do anything. I was like, oh my god. Then, you know, but ultimately we have to get married, because again, you know, I told my mom, please, I don't want to get married, let me do my doctorate degree, maybe then I'll get married. My mom said, no way, you're getting married because you have a sister. Then I said, fine. I just wanted to get rid of my mom's, you know, constant, you know, she went on and on. Then I said, fine, okay. If she's saying it will make sense, you know, then on pure trust, I went ahead, got married. I'm happily married. And thanks to my husband, I did change, you know, perceptions about men. You know, they're not angels, but they're definitely not demons. You know, that is very important. You know, we need to have that, you know, that we need to understand that there is something called gray between black and white. So from the personal experience, let, you know, from the theoretical background, I moved to the personal experience. And now let's come back to the novel. You know, as far as this novel is concerned, it talks about a whole lot of issues. You know, there is this beautiful depiction of Devadasis. But what really struck me is there is no romanticization of Devadasis. You know, Devadasis are not portrayed as, you know, you know, they're portrayed very, you know, with their own frailties, with their own faults, you know, it's beautiful. And then, you know, they're also portrayed as, you know, human beings with emotions. They do fall in love. They do want to have a family of their own. They want to lead a normal life. And then it beautifully traces their decline, their fall from, you know, from their place of glory, and then how they cope with it, you know, and then how, you know, it is how they are forced to migrate because they are deprived of their livelihood. You know, that is one strand of the novel. And there is this another beautiful strand of the novel which focuses on the relationship between Purna and Raghu. I don't want to give too many details about the novel because I want you all to read the novel. I'm not talking about the speakers as such, about the audience also who may not have read the novel. So I just want to keep the details, you know. But then, you know, that's when, you know, it got, you know, the relationship between Purna and Raghu, that's when got me thinking about this role of gender. You know, first let's look at Raghu. Raghu is in maybe in his mid-50s, and the way she portrays Raghu as tall and handsome, I'm able to picturize him, visualize him as he's tall, handsome, and then, you know, but the oddity is he's a house husband. You know, and then he does all the cooking, cleaning, does all the household chores, and then he plans what to cook. And then, you know, he's very meticulous in planning. You know, when I first read it, I found it odd. That's the truth. Okay. And then, you know, he's very, you know, and then, you know, he goes on with his life. But then as the novel progresses, you realize that, you know, he's not happy. He's stressed out. He does not sleep properly. And he's not very happy with his marriage also. He has a problem with his wife. Yeah. So, and then, you know, actually, he has transgressed the societal boundaries. That's what we can say. You know, here he has swapped the roles. While his wife is the breadwinner, he is somebody who takes care of the house. You know, he is the nourisher of the house, and then he takes care of everything. And then he, right at the beginning of the novel, he tells that he has quit his job because he had to take care of his daughter, who was a sickly child. And then, you know, so, you know, that is actually, you know, it's a rarity. Usually the society expects the women to take, you know, to give up her career, you know, that, you know, give up her career and take care of her child. But here he offers and he actually gives up his career. And then, you know, he tells that had I been in my job, I would have become a zonal manager. That means he did have a good, decent job, but he gave up everything and to take care of the household. But then that's where the, you know, problem lies, you know, because actually, as you know, there is something like, you know, there is a dissonance between his personality and the societal expectations. You know, as a personality, you know, his own personality, you know, he is very happy playing the role of a house husband. But then the constant societal expectation, you know, somewhere he feels their glare, you know, the gaze, the societal gaze, that's what I would say. You know, it is not... it's not visible. The invisible societal gaze, you know, constantly puts him under stress. You know, that's what I felt, you know, that, you know, he's frustrated. You know, he keeps telling that, you know, I just want to. And then he even floats that event management company, but he does not bother to take care of the company. Then I thought, why is he not bothering now that his daughter is grown up? And then, you know, nowhere in the novel, it's been told that, you know, it has been even suggested that they are suffering from any financial troubles. He can as well hire a servant maid and then, you know, she can take care of all the household chores and he can definitely take care of his management company. But he does not do that. He refrains from it. Why? Maybe because he's happy playing the role of a house husband and that's perfectly fine. But then... the dissonance in his personality arises because he's constantly aware of the societal expectations that, you know, what will the society think? You know, that constant, he is under the constant society scrutiny. So that's where I think, you know, I think that is where, you know, that is a source of his stress. You know, even if you look at his wife, you know, Meena, you know, it's more on a rebound that she marries him. Again, she's also very bothered about this appearances, you know. It's not that, you know, she has a great relationship with her husband. And she does know that her husband is having an extramarital affair. Somewhere in the novel, we just come to know that even she's cognizant of the fact. But she does not do anything to rein him. She's okay with it. As far as the society does not know, she's fine with it. Again, they, you know, they continue in that relationship for the society's sake, you know. That is one aspect. Now let's move to Purna. Now, as far as Purna is concerned, you know, when I first read about Purna, I, you know, I'm more of that visualizing person. You know, I immediately visualized her as somebody in her 40s, early 40s with long flowing hair and beautiful prominent eyes and very beautiful woman. You know, that's how I visualized her. And then she's an accomplished dancer, very passionate about dancing. And then she's also, she's a divorcee, she's a single woman. And, you know, she lives with her guardian who happens to be her mother-in-law. And then when I looked at, you know, what led to a divorce, you know, divorces does not mean that the other partner is a demon. Not at all. You know, sometimes, you know, two perfectly, you know, two good individuals can, you know, the incompatibility arises. It does not mean that, you know, he has indulged in, you know, wife beating or she has indulged in psychologically torturing him. It somehow things don't work out, you know, then it may lead to a divorce. So I thought, you know, what led to that marital discord? Then again, I felt patriarchy is the reason behind it because Sam, her husband, you know, former husband, does not allow her to dance. You know, he says that I will not allow you to dance. Again, you know, men are constantly told that your wife, you are, you know, you possess her. She is your trophy and you'll have to protect her. So, you know, when she goes and gives a dance presentation somewhere, maybe he feels insecure. So, you know, and he does not want that to, you know, he does not want that to happen. So, you know, he forbids her from giving any dance performances and she's very passionate about it. And she's not somebody who will give up her passion for the sake of her marriage. Absolutely fine. At the end of the day, this is our life and we'll have to lead it on our own terms. Sometimes, yes, marriages call for adjustments. Adjustments are fine, but not a compromise. There is a thin line between compromise and an adjustment. And she refuses to make a compromise. She's willing to make adjustments because, you know, when, and then she has a relationship, a virtual relationship with Raghu. That's when, you know, it struck me that we live in this globalized era. Actually, we live in an accelerated globalized era where technological advances, you know, help us connect. So here, you know, the WhatsApp, you know, it it acts as a bridge between them. You know, she is in Singapore and he lives in Chennai, but still they are able to have this beautiful relationship between them. But somewhere, you know, relationships, you know, technology will help you, will enable you in starting or forming a bond. But to nurture that bond and to take that bond to the next level, you need that personal touch. I think this pandemic has taught that no matter what technology you have, you definitely require that personal touch. You know, in this context of pandemic, you know, this novel, very subtly it tells that, you know, technology is definitely an enabler. It is a boon, but you require that personal touch to nurture that relationship, to take that relationship to that next level. Purna gives it an all to that relationship. You know, sometimes I felt, you know, Raghu has been very unfair. You know, I just didn't like the way he talks to her. But Purna, puts up very, you know, she's very stoic in that way. You know, I felt that will I take it? Maybe, because, you know, she's so emotionally invested in Raghu, you know, which she could not with Sam. You know, that's where I felt very bad for Purna. And then I started praying that she should definitely find someone. Then I thought, why a male? Maybe a friendship will do. But then I thought, can we substitute a male relationship, you know, a relationship like that with a friendship? There are no substitutes. That's what I realized from this novel. You know, one relationship cannot substitute another relationship. All relationships have their own place and they play their own roles. Can, you know, me being a mother to my son is different from me being a wife to my husband. My husband is important, you know, in certain ways. My son also is very important in certain ways. My career is also important in certain ways. This makes me a whole, you know, this makes my life a holistic experience. Similarly, as far as Purna is concerned, you know, their relationship ossifies after a point of time. You know, they could not take to the next level. Again, maybe because of the societal pressures. Maybe Raghu is worried that if he has an extramarital affair and if he decides to formalize it, what will happen about, you know, what will happen to his daughter? Maybe, whatever, you know, we are not here to pass judgments on his decisions. But then, you know, Purna suffers an emotional breakdown. But then that's where, you know, sorority comes, you know, through this novel, you know, Jayanti, you know, she presents that, you know, very subtly presents that there is a strategy to combat the negative effects of a breakup. If you are having a breakup, then definitely sorority, you know, your female bonding can help you, you know, come out of it. You know, it will help you, you know, fight it out. You know, we definitely require our family support, but very unfortunately, Purna does not have a family. But in this, on behalf of, rather than her family coming to her aid, we have her friend, you know, Jayanti, you know, coming to her aid, and then her house help, you know, coming to her help, and then her mother-in-law. Actually, this is a very refreshing take on mother-in-law. Usually mothers-in-law are portrayed as demons and, you know, who make their daughters-in-law lives miserable. But here we have, again, a very realistic portrayal, because, you know, they do have a fight, but then they do come together. That is how it is. It is not that, you know, we always, you know, we fight, we come back. It is not that we fight and we go away. We move apart. You know, so this novel, you know, it made me think that maybe in a very subtle way, this novel is calling, or rather envisioning, a post-gender society, a society where there are no genders as such. See, gender ultimately is a performance. Every day I perform the role of a female. Every day my husband performs the role of a male. But then, you know, but then within the family, on Sundays, I'll say that, you know, he himself says that you don't bother about cooking, I'll cook. Or if we both don't want to cook, we'll get it from outside. So, you know, slowly, I won't say that, you know, as soon as, you know, from Monday, my husband will be preparing tea and I will be going for work. That is not right, actually. It is about, you know, equal distribution of, you know, duties and responsibilities so that we both can have our careers. You know, it is not easy, you know, juggling your, you know, usually I have a problem with, you know, women being portrayed as superwomen. Absolutely not. It is not possible. You know, there are lots of myths being circulated that, you know, a woman can play the role of a mother, a woman can play the role of a career woman, a woman can take care of, you know, the house. No, we do have our meltdowns. We are human beings. Don't portray, don't take us to, don't pedestalize us. Don't take us to that level of, you know, superpowers. No, not at all. If it is not possible, we'll a simple and one tea. That too, we'll prepare the decoction in the morning and heat it in the evening and give it to everybody. But somehow things will be done. But maybe we'll tweak it here and there. So I think this novel calls for that. You know, what it calls is that, you know, rather than, you know, a swap of roles, you know, males playing the role of a female and the females playing the role of a male, somewhere this novel, you know, through Raghu and you know, Purna, it says that it is time that we think about this middle path where both men and women come together. You know, ultimately it is about coming together and how you solve these problems, how you build strong relationships. I think, you know, that is the key takeaway from this novel. So these are my few insights from my reading. You know, hope you know I did not bore you from my insights.
No, not at all, ma'am. Actually, we were very much interested when you had transitioned from the theoretical to your actually to your personal life. You know, because all of us were thinking when you went into your personal life, we felt like we were there around you. Watching you go through the motions of your life.
I know, because you know, it's a it's an experience, you know, we all go through it, you know, that I think that's what the novel, you know, we are able to connect with this novel because it deals with our experience. It is not something fantastical or out of the world. It is absolutely normal, you know. So especially I went through these stages of life, you know, where I was, you know, indulged in a lot of male bashing and then, you know, oh my God, I have changed my opinion. And then now I have like, you know, we will have to adopt a middle path. There was a time when I wanted to play that role of superwoman also, where I would get up at 5 and then do everything and then go to college and then come back and take care of my son. I'm still doing that, but still somewhere I'm telling myself that Revati, don't assume that you're a superwoman. You are a human being who can do certain things and who cannot do certain things. There will be imperfections. There is nothing like perfection. So I think Raghu is, you know, He is happy being a house husband. I think he should be happy. But it is easier said than done. We will constantly think, what will the society think about me? You know, it's not easy, you know, to transgress the boundaries. You know, these are invisible boundaries that are, etched out by the society, you know, through from generations it has been passed on. So, you know, you do something radical, you face the consequences. That is what, you know, Raghu has faced. And even, you know, Purna has faced. You know, Purna could have easily given up her passion and she could have led a happy married life. But can we call that a happy married life? Maybe apparently, yes. But deep within, she may not be happy. And she refused to compromise on that. So, you know, and then Raghu, you know, he can always, you know, say that, you know, Meena, you take care of the child. I will, you know, go ahead and become a zonal manager. He did not. So, and he is facing the consequences for, you know, taking a different path. So, the road not taken. So, what will happen if you take the road that it has not been taken? But we should have the confidence to take the road not taken. I think that is important, you know. Yes, there will be roadblocks, but your family will come, you know, and then it will help you, you know, overcome those roadblocks, you know, help you face those hurdles, you know. I think that's important.
Definitely.
It's very interesting, Dr. Revati, you brought the issue of, you know, gender equality between men and women in this novel, because I think nowadays, okay, youngsters, they don't see that, you know that give and take within themselves, you know.
Yeah.
So it's always about, you know, I should do this or you should do, you know, you should do that. You know, so I feel that, you know, that is very much needed in this current time.
Yeah.
And also I like the issue of, you know, Devadasis that you brought in this novel. Because usually we have seen, you know, this Devadasis in movies. You know, not only in Tamil movies, but, you know, in Hindi movies and other, you know, languages as well. But, you know, putting that aspect in the book, and also with the issue of, you know, gender, I think it's a great thing.
Yeah. No, but actually, let me tell you the truth. You know, I'm really sorry if I'm taking too much of time. I just want to add this. You know, usually we have this, you know, perception that, you know, why should I be doing this? Why should not he be doing it? You know, we have this problem. You know, but I think, you know, we have to come out of that problem. You know, we have to come out of this problem. You know, there is a dignity of labor. Ultimately, we are doing it for family. But then, you know, women, you know, they keep telling ourselves that I'm doing it for my family. But somewhere, you know, you should be able to do what you like. You know, that how do you do it? I think that a lot of it depends on your family members also. But definitely a change has to come in the mindset, you know. Nowadays, you know, I see a lot of my own cousins say that, you know, I won't cook. I say that there's nothing wrong with cooking. I keep telling my son also, you should learn how to cook. So, you know, there should be that dignity of labor, you know, whatever you do, do it. But at the same time, whatever you love, pursue it. It is easier said than done. But definitely, if we want, you know, if we want a change to happen, we should be the drivers of change. I think we can do it.
I think let's call Gautam.
Yeah. I should apologize to him for taking too much of his time.
No, after the second speech, we are going to touch on
have a discussion.
The topic, both the talks, you know, so that, you know, we have more to discuss. We are going to, Shabdev Kumar, we are going to go to this general role after the second speech.
Yes. Okay.
Over to Danya.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Revati ma'am. It was very engrossing for us to go through your journey, not just as a scholar, but also a woman. In this society of you know, patriarchy, if we want to call it that, and yeah, I would like to introduce our second speaker. Our second speaker is Mr. Gautam Sashidharan. He works as an engineering manager in Hyderabad. He satiates his hunger for words by regularly immersing himself in the world set by different authors and reviews them on social media platforms. A person who wonders about everything happening around him, he does not restrict himself to any particular genre. He has also made an attempt in spinning fictional stories through the anthologies of Hyderabad-based book club Hydra. I request Mr. Gautam to share his experiences about reading Misplaced Heads and what he liked the best. Mr. Gautam, over to you.
Gautam is... I'll be calling him.
Yeah.
Oh, his power went off. He's trying to log in through mobile. So let's wait for as we talk. Maybe, Danya, you can pick up a topic from that talk from Revati.
Yeah. Revati, ma'am, can you switch on your audio and video so I can, we could discuss?
Yeah, sure.
Is it possible? Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
And yeah, while we were going through your talk, I was, this thought just came into my mind, you know, like while you were saying stuff like, this is how the society, what the society has thrust on us rather than what we feel from our own personal experiences or anything, it's what's thrust on us. I have felt the system of patriarchy more pronounced in like events, like, you know, the big events, like maybe death or maybe birth or maybe a marriage or anything. That's where it's most pronounced. Like in a marriage, they say there is this thing that the Indian culture follows that it's called the Kanyadan. It's like the father gives up his daughter to the husband, and I have always found it very, I'm not sure if I should call it very insulting for the woman, or I should call it like, you know, I should just look at it as a glorified form of patriarchy, because the woman is not the father's property to give it away to another man. She's a separate human being.
Yes. That is the reason why, you know, Sam's relationship with Purna is disrupted, because he considers her as a trophy. It is not just in Indian culture. In any culture, you know, I see that, you know, they have this perception. You know, but somehow, you know, patriarchy, you know, that's what, you know, A patriarchy is actually an ideology that has been drilled into our heads from centuries. It is time that we rethink patriarchy. You know, we will have to reshape it to suit our sensibilities, you know, but definitely we have come a long way. You know, now, you know, if a woman says that I don't want to cook, I'll get, you know, food through Swiggy, people are like, fine. Earlier, you know, they still make jokes, you know, in movies and all this, there are many jokes being circulated that, you know, is she going to cook or is she going to be, you know, Swiggy wife, you know, but
Swiggy wife. That's
you know, true. Swiggy wife, you know, I remember watching a movie recently where they said that, is she going to be a Swiggy wife, you know, but at least they're okay with it. So, you know, but the problem is you should not, you know, my biggest contention is don't gender any household chore. If there is a household chore and if the wife is busy, let the husband take it up. And if the husband is busy, let the wife take it up. There should not be this competition going on between the wife and the husband. You know, that is the biggest problem, you know, nowadays, you know, that why should I do? Even I am earning this much of money. It is not about how much money you earn.
Yeah.
It is about the work has to be done. How do you do it? Yeah. That is how, you know, that. You know, where we no longer gender it. That is why I, you know, I feel that this novel, you know, it envisions a post-gender society. The moment you stop gendering it, you know, that is, you know, that is when, you know, your life will be a better life. You stop gendering.
I think this generation's parents are more forward like this, because one of my cousins, she has a small daughter. Like my niece is around like 7 years old. And one day what she had asked the mother was like, the mother has asked her, you know, like generally all mothers do, what do you want to become when you grow older? And she said, I want to be dad. She said, I want to be dad because he goes out to work, he earns money. And she is mama has asked her, why would you want to be dad? Why wouldn't you want to be a mother? And she has told, no, I don't want to stay at home and cook like you and do nothing else. So this cousin of mine, she called me. She said, I don't want my daughter thinking like this. You take her to your office, show her that women can also work. We can also come back home. Doesn't have, it's not the dad's role to, you know, earn the money. And we were laughing. We had a huge laugh.
That kind of 7-year-old. Most of the times they have that hero worship towards father. That is also mixed in that. So
she was asking me when I had taken to her, taken her to my office, she was asking, so you run this office? So there are men working under you? I was so shocked when she asked that question. She asked me, do men work under you or just women? Mm. You can lead men also? She was asking me and I was having a hearty laugh. I think Mr. Gautam is available. Can we, Mr. Gautam, yes. Can we, is it possible for you to switch your video and audio on? Can we go on to the speech? Mr. Gautam, can you hear me? I think his connection is a little interrupted.
Yeah, having trouble.
Should we go on with the discussion, Auntie? Should we go on or should we wait for a
bit? He comes. Let's. Yeah, Gautam, you can start your.
Yeah. Sorry, I.
No worries. Please start. Let's hear what you have to say.
Good evening. So I'm just going to talk about how I felt when I read. Displaced it. So, incidentally, I have read Dandy Mam's first book, Dangling Dan. So, obviously, for a reader, we always have a preset mind that what is going to come in the second book would be on the same lines. So, I also went with the same biased opinion that it will follow the same line of thought. Coming to Misplaced Head. So, just let me give a short review of what I said. So, basically the book covers two parallel stories. The first one being Polas, who is in her 50s and engages in a romantic relationship with somebody called Rebo. It's more like a virtual relationship. And this is basically the core of the book and the most obvious layer of the book. The most intriguing part of this story is, for me, is Raghu's behavior. Because I felt Poorna's behavior is more or less kind of expected when somebody fails, is let down and all things. But my intriguing part was why Raghu behaved the way he behaved. And the beauty of this was it leaves, the author leaves it to the reader to decide why it is so. She does not give it in plain words that this is why Raghu behaved like this. It is throughout the book, you have the reader has the freedom to decide why Raghu behaved like that. And it is not given it given by the author, but it is up to the reader to decide on it. So the second parallel story just running in the book is of the Devadasis. Now, the story of Devadasis is very disjoint. It is not like it follows one and the next chapter follows it exactly from that part. And it is not like that. It's a very disjoint narrative and it allows, again, the author allows the reader to imagine a lot of things from the narrative. so it starts from right from 100 BC, wherein the scene is set in Athens, and it progresses, but it is not the story which is thrown light on, but the visual the state of the eliteness of women in the society. That is where the light is thrown. And the book basically traces the path of Devadasis from being one of the elites in the society to being pushed to become as prostitutes. So this path is what is being faced in the course of the book. So one hidden layer, or which is very not very obvious, is the story of the temples also, which is embedded along with the story of the Devadasis. It traces how temples were the center of the society or for the social and economic development of the society at one point of time, and how it slowly loses its value and becomes, as on date, a mere place of worship. So this story is also embedded in that narrative, which is not very obvious, but it is embedded. So the third part is what I wanted to tell is both these parallel stories culminate at one point of time, and that is how the book comes to an end. And the climax of the book is, I don't want to feel it as much to the reader, because I want every one of you to read it, but it ends with hope. That is what the author is showing at the end of the story. Now, if I want to summarize in a nutshell, there is one particular line in the book which says, "All distorted sounds, so beautiful and exciting. Oh, how exciting!" And that is how I felt all throughout the book. The book does not allow you to settle. It does not leave you to be in your comfort zone. It pushes you. And that is one of the most beautiful points of this book. Be it the story of Poorna, be it the story of Raghu, be it the story of the Devadasis, or how Poorna ends up being born in Singapore. It also pushes you or creates discomfort in the form of the stories of Tarun, Rishi, Arush, and Tanya also. If you see the book's flow, there is a fluidity in the Poorna story, but there is a complexity in the book's story. The idea of roles, as Madam was also telling, the idea of roles play a truant role in the complete book. And that, I believe, is the core line of the book which man has envisaged and given to us. So for me, the most beautiful, if you ask me which chapter was the most striking for you, of course it was the first chapter where Lacan's descriptions are made. That is the most beautiful part of me. But there are many other chapters which made me, in fact I would say the whole book made me sit and read. See, usually you readers, we feel comfortable sitting lying on the lying on bed and read, or sit in an easy chair and read. But no, this book does not allow you to do that. From first page till the last page makes you sit and takes your attention and keeps you engrossed. I think that's how I felt. I do have many questions for madam, and I think there we will discuss more. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Gautam. I think the forum can be open for discussion. Anyone who has questions for the speakers or the author or anyone in the forum can just have a discussion, have an open discussion.
Gautam said he has questions. He can begin. And of course, we have the gender roles as well. We will touch those also. Gautam, can you begin with the question, please? To anyone, even to Revati, Danya, anyone.
Ma'am, first my question is to you.
To me?
Okay. Yes.
Right.
So, the book has two, as I was telling, the book has two parallel lines. One is Purna and Raghu's story, and one is Devadasi's story.
Yes.
So, there are some associated lines, which is Tanya's story, maybe Tarun's story.
Yes.
And there is also one line running between Shweta and Nupur.
Yes.
Could you please throw some light on how these characters are embedded into the story?
Okay. Normally, I consider a novel different from a short story. A short story is just a small period of time. Maybe within a few hours or maybe a day, should complete very fast, a small bit. Whereas a novel is a wider canvas that can be said like, say, a big lump of life or a bucket of water from the ocean, if I can say that. That's how a novel is. And how is life? You and I, we, every one of us, Revati or Dhanya or Shabdev, anyone, we all know we have the closest of circles around us. Maybe next level of circles of friends, and rarely contacting friends and acquaintances and passers-by, just smiles in the bus. So life is not about only the primary characters. I'm the protagonist and antagonist and a few. Life is never like that, isn't it? When we project life in a novel, obviously secondary characters will be there. And cursory characters, very minor characters, will also be there. If they are not there, what happens is it becomes singular. And when it is singular, I don't think it can be said as a novel. This is it comes like whatever I said just now is about novel as it is in the form and content. Coming to Misplaced Heads, Tanya, for example, if I had not written Tanya is not in the novel, Displaced Heads, then it's almost singular. Only Purna line will be there. Purna developed as she has to develop. For me, as a woman with all kinds of, like Revati said, feminism is there, but we also know I am a human being and we're all human beings. At the same time, we have such idealistic thoughts as well. As in, okay, Poorna is like this, but she grew to be like that, depressed and weak. In some way, she's weak. In some other way, she's strong. But she's in mid-50s, right? How will she be if she's a young woman of 30? That is the question that comes to me. So I become Tanya and I take Tanya to tell certain ideas and things that I would like to tell the readers. Tanya's character is the secondary character that is complementing my first character in such a way that, you know, whatever she's not, she is. Whatever she is not, she is. It helps me take forward my contemporary main threads. Tanya is important for me. Coming to Tarun, Tanya has a brother. That's all. I can just say in a sentence and just move on. But that's not how a storyteller does. Especially in a novel where we have so much scope to tell and show rather than tell, I have to show. What I did, I took Tarun's inner worlds to show bits and pieces that the readers can connect and get the picture, image of what he is, what is his background, what are his thoughts. So those are Nupur and Shweta. Nupur character with Payal as the young child, that was a cursory character, not even a minor character. That helped me because Shweta is a reporter. She takes interview of Tanya, as you know. She also stands by as a dance teacher and all. Yes. So Shweta is there. Shweta is Tanya's friend. But Shweta will have some other phases of her life also. And this Nupur helped me with showing the, you know, dating apps are so popular past decade. You know, it's, I mean, it has its own positives and negatives, the dating apps. So this Nupur married at the same time, and he's a very good man. She herself says in that. He's not a bad person. So they both are, like Revati just now said, they both are good people. They are not compatible. So she goes for a dating app. Why I need this? Why I need this small cursory character or branch of a story is mainly to show what are the things going on now in such relationship or seeking such relationship. After all, the whole story, the whole novel is about Devdas is there. I mean, the woman, how she feels, how she goes, I mean, how she evolves and how she falls. And this Nupur character is helping me show how the dating happened. The modern woman on the other side, well, Tanya is so strong in her beliefs of loyalty, friendship, relationship, everything. Although she doesn't believe in marriage, this Shweta, she holds on to her marriage but goes to dating apps. And they go for their own individual, you know, robots and all that. These are the futuristic thoughts that came to my mind when I was thinking about how the women of the modern world are thinking. So I hope I answered your question. I mean, coming to the eras, you said they're not continuous story. Something like century period wise, eras wise, when I handle, they cannot possibly have a continuous story? The meeting point is Mangai. She is the one who is touching the eras and the contemporary. Mangai's granddaughter is Purna. So in such an historical novel, you cannot possibly touch so many eras at the same time give continuity. These imageries are giving so much for the readers to imagine, and that comes under creative appreciation. A reader's participation is required in such a novel. And that's why you all could read those abstract imageries. The abstractness came more beautiful than I had expected. Normally, I am for abstractness. Even in Dangling Gandhi, the short stories were abstract to some extent. That abstractness is very crucial for giving space, the reader's space, reader's participation, creative participation through the reader's imagination. So, these are the things I wanted to tell. I hope. I think you should ask some other person, some other speaker, to answer your next question, Gautam. I will go on talking. please ask Danya or Revati next question.
Yeah. Actually, my question was for Revati, ma'am. There is a line where it is mentioned, roles are not ugly, but the bindings are. So I request, ma'am, can you just put some light on that particular line?
Can you just repeat? Roles are not ugly, but?
Bindings are.
I will definitely look at it from the perspective of gender. As I have already mentioned in my talk, that roles are they are watertight compartment. A woman is expected to play the role of a female, and a man is expected to play the role of a male. We are given a script by the society. And then the script is, and we start enacting the script specifically after getting married. Until as long as we are not married, we are in the safe haven of our house. Mother will take care. And at that point of time, we just don't realize that, father is going out and mother is cooking. In fact, I remember, my own, I had been very mean to my mom. Now when I look back, what are you doing at home? I'm so hungry. Why don't you do something different? The same old pakodas, now you ask me to make pakodas, I'll say, pakodas? They take a lot of time. I can use that time to read a novel. So, but then, these roles, you really start playing these roles once you get bound in a relationship, then that's when you are expected to perform the role of a female. As long as you're a daughter, it's fine. I mean, maybe in an urban space, again, in rural space, I think it is entirely different because a daughter is expected to do various household chores, but it's a thankless job. That is the worst part of it. Then ultimately, what are you? You are a housewife. I'm just a housewife. You are not just a housewife. Please, for heaven's sake, don't say, I will be very happy working in my college, but you would ask me to take care of the household work. It takes a lot of time. It takes a hell lot of time. I realize. And if somebody says that I'm just a housewife, I'll say, oh my God, you're great. Not that, I'm pedestalizing them. But we do have a problem, we kind of it is not monetized. That is where the problem arises, the same work, the kind of work that, a woman does every day, preparing tea and then, cooking and then cleaning and then drying the clothes and then again cooking for the night meal and then in the middle giving snacks to the children, taking care of the children. All that you monetize, you will have to pay at least 25,000 Indian currency. I'm talking about Indian currency. And even then, I doubt if you will get a trustworthy help. But then a woman, she falls sick and then, she says that I know when a woman does not perform that role, And then she becomes, you know, her the utility of a woman comes down, and then, you know, sometimes it leads to a divorce, and sometimes it leads to rude comments from in-laws and even from her own spouse. That's when the bonds become binding, you know, they become very, you know, they start, you know, chaining you up, you know, that's when, you know, these bonds become, you know, they kind of, you know, they chain you up. You know, bonds actually, you know, you get into a relationship because it gives you happiness. But when they don't give you happiness, specifically when you are in need of support, that's when you think, you know, I think this becomes a painful bond. I think I answered your question. It is from my perspective. There is nothing like, you know, right or wrong answers as far as English literature is concerned.
Yeah,
literature is concerned.
Yeah, yeah. I believe what ma'am is trying to say is that boundaries are not to be set.
Yes. But, you know, it is easier said than done. You know, I cannot just, you know, I just cannot tell my husband that today night I'm not going to cook. I just cannot tell like that. You know, I need a solid reason to tell that, you know, I will not be cooking tonight because I need to do some work. At least my husband will say, fine, you do that work. Today I'll cook. But tomorrow I have to get into that shoes of cooking and cook it. But, you know, when, you know, when your family appreciates you for that, you know, I am spending my time. You know, I would rather spend that time, you know, if left to my devices, I would put one dal, eat that dal and keep reading. But I live in a family where they will not, where they're not okay with dal every day. So I am investing my time to keep my family happy. And the moment my family realizes that and appreciates that, that's when we feel, you know, valued. But my, very fortunately, my family does that. They do appreciate my efforts of saying that, you know, yes, you're cooking. You know, they will not, you know, belittle it. What are you doing? After all, you're cooking one sambar and one puriyal. But when we don't cook that puriyal and sambar, they will know the pinch. And, you know, my family, at least it understands that. You know, we should never belittle. You know, and we should not belittle a man's work also. You know, my husband keeps sitting in front of the laptop and keeps peering at the laptop and keeps talking to people. And sometimes in the middle, he keeps watching at the, you know, he keeps looking at his cell phone and keeps talking to his friends. You know, my son says, Daddy, what big work have you done? Throughout the day, you're sitting in front of the laptop and talking to your friends. You know, so you can take me for a ride. No, you are belittling. It is very difficult to sit throughout. And, you know, so the moment we value each person's role, and then, you know, we value that, you know, you should not take somebody's time for granted, whether it is a woman or a man. You know, each person have their own, you know, they have their own ideas about spending their time. But then they are spending that time to uplift the family, then you please value it. The moment we value it, the boundaries are, you know, transcended. That's what I feel. That is important. Rather than
measuring the activities through money.
It is
better to measure it through time.
Time. Don't monetize it, because if I am not there, then my family has to spend minimum 25,000 to 30,000. And imagine during the pandemic, the cook comes, there'll be, you know, so it is not possible. So the moment a woman translates her work into money, the family cannot, you know, then it is not a family. We do it for family. It is our family. But in a similar way, our family also has to appreciate our efforts. They should not take us for granted. You are a woman, you better do it. You are a man, you better be the breadwinner. You know, that the moment we realize and we appreciate each person's effort and, you know, for the upliftment of the family, I think the boundaries are erased. That's what I feel. I hope I have answered your question.
Yeah, of course, Amma. It was really wonderful listening to you.
Yes.
I have one more question. Probably I think Danya can will be able to answer that.
Oh, sure.
As a fellow reader, maybe you can tell me. Throughout the course of the book, I also felt that metaphorically somewhere, the story of Devadasis and temples are quite similar to the story of Poorna. In the sense, both are going in a high in the initial part of the book and slowly it descends. This I found as a metaphorical, as a it is not very obviously told, but I found that relationship. So what do you think about that?
I think that was the point of the author, actually. I think not just through the highs and lows of life or just being women, there is this, you know, both of them are using the art form, that is Bharatanatyam or classical dance, to transcend from their normal lives, to shut down the normal lives and engross themselves in something bigger, larger, so that they can come out of the trials of life and, you know, the negatives of life. Not just, I don't think this stops with Purna, it goes on to Tanya also, because she uses her art also to come out of that broken relationship and, you know, to heal from that. I think maybe that was her point, to make us understand that the art form is more spiritual. You know, it is maybe that, I felt that that was the connection, three stories of Purna, Tanya and the Devadasis. And yes, as a woman, I think any human being will know, with women, the highs and lows are exponentially exaggerated. So the highs and lows, it's not just for Purna, Tanya and the Devadasi. Your sister, your mother, your wife, all of us, we have exponential highs and lows. So more than the highs and lows, I think the art form's significance in their lives, I felt, was a connection between the three characters, or the three, you know, protagonists. Yeah. I think Jayanti ma'am wants to say something.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually, when you said just now, Gautam,
yes,
the graph is same for the ancient era and the contemporary. Till that moment, I didn't realize it has naturally come like that.
Yeah, okay.
And I think these are the creative magics that happen beyond the author's intention. And it happens and the reader catches it. Only when the reader is catching it and giving it, the author realizes. And this is one moment. It happened beyond me. It has happened. When you asked and she was answering, I'm thinking, yeah, it has happened. And Raghav read. Raghav is one of the youngest readers of the manuscript. And after he finished, he came and told me, Purna is the modern representation of Devadasi. He read it like that, my younger son. I couldn't answer him. I didn't respond to him for a minute. He went away. He told and he went away. And I was cooking and I thought, yes, it was not intentional, but it is. It has come like that. That was the first, and this is the second, similar moment for me. That you read it like that, and it is, when I think back, and thanks for that. These are the creative appreciation. These come under creative appreciation. Thanks,
Doc. I think as readers, we connect to certain flows better than the others. Like the last meet also, all of the entire, you know, the audience or the speakers were all concentrated on Purna, but I as a reader was more connected to Tanya, maybe because I was from this generation and I could relate to her better than a Purna or anything. And to me, what I felt for Tanya was that, like Jayanti ma'am had said, you know, there will be stories or movies and books that we read and we wish that the ending was not that way, you know, like maybe one of them suffers or one of them dies, but all of us go back with the baggage of the movie. And sometimes we go home and think, why wouldn't it have ended some other way? Why didn't Purna just move on? You know, why couldn't she have just gone on? It's not like she's married to this man. Why can't she just move on and just have a better life? And that, you know, that yearning for us, I felt that was satisfied with Tanya's story. I felt like she was the answer. If Purna had been this generation woman and she had gone through the same situation in the 2020s, she would have been Tanya. And we would have liked the story better. So to cater to the various audience, when you're above 35, 40, you will connect more with Purna because your mind is conditioned that way. When you are 25 to 35, maybe your mind will think like Tanya. You know, you will be like, just go, no, just leave the man and go on. Why do you have to stick on to that person so much? Right? And her independence, I felt like Jayanti ma'am had answered that question for us. To any reader who felt like, why would Purna do this? I think that was answered by Tanya's representation of life.
For me, Purna being the protagonist, I had to live her role. The whole of 2019, I was only living like Purna, thinking and all, because I had to. But I know in the heart of my heart, I am Tanya. I know that. So for example, you can say Tanya is an alter ego of Purna. You can also read it like that.
See, I felt that Tanya is a foil to Purna.
Yes, foil. Yes, true. And then catering to all you, Tanya said. Normally, except for pulp fiction or cinema or any kind of, even an art film or anything, the catering thought will come. For me, it didn't come. I didn't have to cater to anyone, but I was analyzing the psychology of various kinds of women. In fact, I wanted Purna to be the way Tanya turned out to be, and I wanted the secondary character to be weak like Purna. That was initial thought. That was my initial thought. But it turned out to be like this. And I thought, okay, let it be like this. If it is like this, if it was the other way around, probably it would have been like something idealistic. That kind of a novel I didn't want. I wanted something... something that will, it should be raw, abstract, and slapping truth, and the possibilities. Of course, there are exceptions, exceptional, weird, queer things. But then, many of the chapters were formed when I was in my alpha state of sleep, actually. And that Purna's dream that she is pregnant, heavily pregnant, that chapter was from a dream that I had early morning. I was heavily pregnant and I suddenly woke up. And that heaviness was there for half an hour. And I was thinking, I was lying down thinking, oh, how strong the dream is. This is all I had. Nothing more. I didn't have any details of the dream. But that alone, I took it from my fiction. I brought so many things for that. It's again a metaphor. The chapter itself is a metaphor there. So you said there are so many metaphors all the way. Yes, but not intentional. It happened that way. For example, the monk and the nun talking. Tanya, the Purna sees. She happens to see a couple sitting in on the slopes of Darjeeling. That's all. She mentions it, and that's where this chapter that the reader can connect an imaginary dialogue. And that dialogue, of course, holds good for the whole novel also. So asking so many questions. So this is actually an experimental fiction. This comes under experimental novel, where it's not just the story that is happening, the incidents, or the pains and emotions. Also, more of inner worlds. That's what Misplaced Heads did to me. I analyzed the inner worlds of my characters more in this novel. Yes. You can ask your next question. Thank you. You all can also ask questions.
I think I have one question for Jayanti ma'am. because gender roles is the topic today.
Yes.
It is easy for us to, like, as not just as, you know, just as women, for us, it's easy to get into another woman's mind.
Yes.
But for her to transition from woman's mind and go into a man's mind and still not vilify him, right? Though Raghu is, his character comes out to be, you know, the negative one.
Mm-hmm.
Being in his shoes, yet not vilifying him, yet going into a man's mind, how did it feel for you to transition from Purna's or like Tanya's into Raghu's mind and write about it?
I will go to what Revati said. I mean, in spite of all male, female roles and all, we're all human beings. And I consider myself more a human being than a woman. I think for a writer, if she can become Purna or Tanya, then she can become Tarun. She should be able to become Rishi and Raghu. If she's not able to, then she cannot write about men or create men characters. And if there are no men characters, there cannot be a novel. After all, men and women are living in the world. Like I said, a novel is a pail full of ocean water. And in that, of course, men will be there. And a writer has to take roles of both men and women when she's writing. And in fact, when you are saying this, I have to tell again, I think I told last session, my work in progress novel is fully male-centric, meaning main characters are all men, secondary characters also. Of course, women will be there, no doubt, just the way this misplaced text is having. Women characters will come, but it's male-centric and it's a Singapore novel. So that's for an information. And this challenge I have deliberately taken. So you can imagine how it's going to be. The main character, a Chinese guy, he has a special, the character is forming in my mind, not yet written, chapters also not yet. But this particular character is going to really really be challenging, but I have to do it, and that's the challenge that I'm looking forward to. And of course, we can read, we can also get some man to review the first draft and all that. I can do. Whether I'm going to do or not, I don't know. I would rather not. Let's see.
I request Sabdev sir, do you have any questions that you would like to add, or do you have, you want to tell us how you felt about the meeting, about the talk? I think you're muted.
You're mute. Yes.
All right. Okay. It's very interesting. I'm enjoying it actually, but I need to get the book. Yeah. Yes. So once I have gotten the book, then I will let you know my feedback. But this is, this is actually what interests me, you know, because my area of interest is actually Indian writings in English. So I'm able to, associate with what, with what you all are saying. And I have a question to Dr. Revati. While writing this novel, how was the writing process like?
I think he's meaning Miss Jayanti Shankar is the author of the novel.
Okay. Yes. How was the writing process like, Ms. Jayanti?
Okay.
Yeah.
This is a historical novel. And the seed was sown by a friend's friend. She's Mridula. She was living in Singapore and she migrated to Australia last December. She wanted her story written. She has her ancestors in Tanjavur. They were temple dancers. she tried to search for her roots, although she couldn't. She kept trying, and now she has given up because she's not able to get any clues. That's all. And like anyone would know, like Danya would know, you would know, Gautam would know, Revati would know. I knew that much fundamental knowledge on Devdas and the system of heritage dances. That's all I knew. But she talked to me a few times because I was postponing it. I said, you are capable of writing your own life. Do it as an autograph biography. Or even if it is a fiction, you can also do it. But she said, no, you do it, you do it. Normally, people wouldn't want their story written as novel or a fiction. They will be somewhat shy about it, or they may think, you know, ashamed of it or something. But Mrutula thought, I can bring a good fiction out of that skeleton that she told me. We had many, many sessions of talking over the phone, video, and everything. She gave me many, many details about her search as well as her long distance and everything. But I didn't use not even 1/10 of what she gave me because I can't possibly put everything what she gave me, then call it a fiction. It's not a fiction anymore. I wanted it to be a fiction, as in really fiction. So what I thought, I will do my own research. So I read a lot. I read lots of books. And I met one particular old man who took me in Vrali Malai, near Trichy. There's a Vrali Malai, one small mountain. Lord Muruga temple is there. And there are the peacocks you can still see. That place, he took me, and there I met an old lady, almost bedridden. She has all her ancestors in temple dances, as temple dances. They gave me so much, but although I couldn't use any of whatever they said, they had their own experiences their ancestors and all that. But my research reading gave me a lot of stuff. So the challenge came when I had so much folders and folders of research material from at least 100 books. But the challenge came when I had to write my fiction. How much I'm going to use, what I will use, what I won't use. So not even 1/100 I have used. They're all there in the folders. People ask me, are you going to write another novel, or are you going to write a non-fiction book? No. There's no point writing a non-fiction book, I feel, because I read so many non-fiction books to get those notes. What's the point in writing another non-fiction book? So that's not in my mind. So for me, so I decided on one, Mrudula being the skeleton of Purna, the protagonist, contemporary thread. So the contemporary threads with many characters should move forward. The Devdasi system, the Devdasis, that each era, how it is going to come. That was the challenge for me. But my when I thought, okay, let me think of how they were living a very glorified, very respected life, and how after the colonial period, the British East India Company, after they came, how they fell. This graph, if I can give the readers, it's good enough. If that is the case, what will the research material that I'll be using, I thought. And then that's how it came about. It wasn't easy writing, and it turned out to be longer than I had expected, even though I cut short. it turned out to be longer. It's an experimental fiction where you will have some, you need patience to read, but like Gautam said, you have to sit and read. You can't casually, read and go somewhere, read another half of the chapter. That's not how, it demands your focus and your full attention. And that's when you can appreciate connecting them. And so that's how, did I answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, thank you very much.
I would like to add something here.
Gautam, yes.
if you want to appreciate this, I would suggest you read it at least 2 times. And you can hear me.
No. Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay.
Yeah. To appreciate this book, I think it's my personal opinion that this book should be read at least twice.
Yes.
And after reading, you should leave some time to settle it in your brain. Because I will tell you something personal here. The last week we had a similar session, and that was the time I was almost going to finish the book, and after I finished the book, I had sent a mail to ma'am. So that time we had a discussion over it, and ma'am, let me tell you, I am being frank here.
Yes.
After a week, I have a different purview of the book. Because what I felt a week back is not what I'm feeling today. And that's why you find that what I spoke 1 week back and today I'm having a different view of it.
But it's all interesting for me. For me, it's always that's how I like it. And I love to watch that transformation. Now you know it is not an easy novel. Of course, you told me it's not an easy novel and all. And I like the way you said it has to sink in and give some time even after the second read. Yes, true. And one person asked me, how dare you write like this? How can it reach to people? How will it sell and all? Selling is important, yes. Reaching many readers also, I would love it, yes. But the creative process itself is what will stay with me always. And for that creative process to be memorable in me, it should be as beautiful. I must, create challenges for myself. And I must love what I write. And once that's all done, it's not mine anymore. Because the experience of the creative experience is mine, that's all. Later, it's all readers. And that said, creative appreciation is very important for this book, this kind of books. I would rather write to decent readers like you all than I shouldn't take names and sell many, many copies. No. I would rather not write. So I respect my readers. They're all more intelligent than me. And therefore, by creating challenges during the creative process, I'm actually giving them challenge to perceive and connect and assimilate and think and ask questions, create discussions. And that's how a novel should be. Rather than I give you, you consume. No, it shouldn't be the case, I think. Then there's no purpose in the novel. Though that comes under those pulp. You buy when you board a train, you keep browsing till midnight, you finish it, keep it. Early morning when you get down to at your station, you can just put it in the dustbin and just go. Because it's not worth reading another time. It's just time pass. just time pass. My writings are not time pass like readings. Did I answer your question, Gautam? Did I?
Yeah, of course. Yes, ma'am. Okay, no. Yeah.
Thank you.
Does anyone have more questions, or should we wrap up the session for the day?
Do you have Sabdev Kumar? Are you from KL?
Yes, from KL, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Are there any more sessions
three more.
Yes. Three more. Okay, all right.
Same time, Saturdays, this is the second one.
Okay, yeah. All right.
Yeah, different topics.
So how do I get this information, ma'am? Is it available on a website or about the current?
Yes, available in Facebook, Instagram, everywhere. Do you want to connect to Instagram?
I have Facebook, Instagram as well. Yeah. Anything
Instagram handle, you can take down my Instagram handle.
Let me check
my Instagram handle. I have to check.
Okay.
I think it is,
J-E-Y-A-N. T-H-I.
S-A-N.
S-A-N.
K-A-R.
K-A-R.
28.
Okay.
That's the Insta handle.
Okay. All right. Okay. Yeah. JNT Sankar 28. Yeah. Okay. All right. I have started following you. Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome to attend all the three more.
Sure.
Danya and myself will be there. Gautam, I guess, will be there. So, two more topics. Yes? Gautam?
Of course, I will be there, ma'am. There is no doubt about it.
Fantastic. Thanks for that support. Revati, you're welcome. So we can wrap.
Before wrapping, I just want to...
Yes.
Congratulate ma'am that the book has been nominated for the Island Book Award.
Thank you.
Yeah. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Finalist.
Congratulations, ma'am. Yes.
30th December is the final result. And of course, once it comes out, I can share. And if I'm not the winner, you will all know that there's no news. So it's only a finalist.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to wrap up this fruitful discussion. Thank you, dear speakers, Dr. Revati and Mr. Gautam, and the author, Ms. Jayanti. I am grateful to the invitees for their time, nifty discussion, and cooperation. Let us all make time next Saturday, the 5th of December at 5 p.m. Indian time for the next round of discussion and knowledge sharing with Ms. Usha Nagaswamy and myself and our experiences with misplaced heads. I thank you all on behalf of the organizers, the speakers, the first readers, publishers, and the author of Misplaced Heads. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.